So the purpose of this talk, the first one, is to give some free field theory examples of general phenomena. In a way, this will be very elementary, but I will present examples of increasing degree of complexity, demonstrating different phenomena, and some of these phenomena are well known in the literature from different points of view, and you can classify every phenomenon or every discussion in the literature, whether it's done on the lattice or in the continuum or using Hamiltonian formalism, which is more common in condensed matter physics, or Lagrangian, and also whether it gives the general theory of what is or is not allowed very abstractly versus giving a very explicit concrete example that one can just follow the algebra and check. So for the most of this talk, I'll be using mostly Lagrangian formulation, although that would not be essential. What will be essential is that I'll be using continuum language. There will not be any underlying lattice. And unlike giving a general overview presentation, I will stick to very, very concrete examples. And in that sense, this talk will be closely related to the beautiful talk we've just heard from Robert. He had an abstract general presentation of topological field theory, whereas I'll have very explicit, concrete free field theory examples of the phenomena that he described. And in that sense, this talk should be viewed as a TA session of his. And therefore, it's really appropriate to use the blackboards. So I'm going to start with the first example. And it's in any d plus 1 dimensions. And at the d plus 1 dimensions, I'll try to stick to this terminology. I always say plus 1 so that there's no confusion how many dimensions we are in. This is when we talk across fields, this is always a confusing point. And my first example will have a very simple action, S, which will be 1 over 2 pi integral phi dA, where phi is a compact scalar. So phi is identified with phi plus 2 pi, and it's dimensionless. And A is a deformed gauge field, and it's subject to gauge transformation laws. A goes to A plus d lambda, where lambda is the appropriate object. I assume this is known. If there's anything you don't understand, please interrupt me. I encourage you to ask questions. This is a school. This is not a seminar that I have to finish.
Are we on RD?
At the moment, we are on RD plus 1. On RD plus 1, but we'll soon change that. And I'll say what happens when we put a boundary. We'll go through all the steps that Robert did in this free field theory. And that's a free field theory because it's Gaussian. So this is the terminology. Free field theory is the same as Gaussian. The action is quadratic in the fields. And as I like to say, it might be very subtle, but there's really no excuse not to understand it because there's nowhere to hide. Everything can be explicitly calculated. I also want to relate what I'll be doing here to the beautiful talks we heard from Kane last week. He started from free electrons. And then he derived all sorts of structure at long distances. And then there was a question of what interactions between the electrons, how they can change it. Throughout all these talks, I'll be only at long distance. The short distance physics could be very complicated in interacting and so forth. And I'm only going to limit, and I'm going to limit myself to theories that are free at long distance. So this is the theory I would like to study. And A is a gauge field, which in general has many indices. Throughout most of the talks, you can think of us being in 1 plus 1 dimensions. And then this A is an ordinary gauge field in 1 plus 1 dimension. And its quanta is such that the integral of dA on every close 2 cycle is always 2 pi times an integer. Now, we could add to this Lagrangian, or to this action, additional terms. We can add, for example, what we call a theta term, which just add a term like that to the Lagrangian, or to the action. But we can absorb this parameter theta in the shift of phi, and therefore we are not going to do that. And that means that this system, despite appearance, does not have symmetry under phi goes to phi plus a constant. That's not a symmetry, unless this constant takes special values, which would be 2 pi over n, as I'll soon show. Okay, so what do we do when we have such a field theory? So the first thing we need to do. Yes, thank you. N is the hero of this story, and I left him out. Poor N. N. Without this N, this story is trivial, but with N, it's less trivial. So the question I'm going to ask now is, what's the physics of this simple system? So in order to answer it, we should first ask ourselves, what are the operators? What are the observables that we can compute? And there are two kinds of observables we can compute. The first is e to the I phi. Notice that it has to be invariant under shifts of phi by 2 pi, and that's a good thing to have. And we can raise that to various powers. So this is an operator inserted at a point, and it generates a whole set of other operators. We can also have e to the I, a closed surface, dA, where this M is dimension D manifold. It could be closed. And now I can make the structure a little bit more interesting because of your question. I can take space, say, to be a sphere, and then this thing can wrap the sphere. Or I can take one of the dimensions of this M, run a long time, and then have codimension. It will be a codimension one surface in space. So I can orient this M different ways. And depending on how I orient it, it has a different interpretation. If it acts at fixed time, it is an operator acting on the Hilbert space. If the same object is aligned a long time and the rest of the dimensions are in space, then it should be viewed as a defect in space-time. Something that sits there. But from the point of view of this Lagrangian, they're all the same. We just rotate it. And therefore, I'll use the word observable or defect operator interchangeably. Yes, Juan? You are completely right. Keep making mistakes. Now it's a lot better. Thank you. It's actually correct in my notes. So let's compute some correlation function. And the simplest thing we can do is just insert e to the I phi at a certain point, and e to the I, say, around the sphere of the point A. It's a manifold, and that's a closed surface. And since this theory is Gaussian, it's straightforward to compute. This is a Gaussian integral, so we can just compute the partition function.
I'm sorry, A is a one form.
A is a deform. And it's actually a connection. It's actually, yeah, but it's a higher form version of it. So A is really a connection, and lambda is also a connection of 1 degree less. But for most of this talk, we can think of D as being one, and then A is an ordinary gauge field, and then lambda is a scalar, and only e to the I lambda is single value. So let's compute this correlation function. This is a Gaussian theory. And the answer is straightforward. It's e to the 2 pi I over n times L, where L is the linking number. So this is a point P, is the linking number of the point P and a manifold M. For example, imagine this M being a sphere. Then L is 1 if the point is inside the sphere, and it's 0 if it's outside. And we can make the topology a little bit more complicated. So this is a straightforward computation in free field theory. I'd like to say a few words about the equations of motion of this theory. In fact, I should have started perhaps with that. If we vary with respect to A, with respect to phi, we vary with respect to phi over there, we'll learn that dA is 0. If we vary with respect to A, we find that d phi is 0. So it tells us that the theory is almost completely empty. In fact, it's almost complete. It's almost right that the theory is empty. There are no local degrees of freedom because phi has to be a constant and A has to be a flat connection or flat gauge field. But if we worry a little bit more carefully, for example, imagine space has a circle in it and phi varies along the circle in such a way that it comes back to itself. That gives us another condition on A, which quantizes the operators and tells us that e to the I and phi is 1 as an operator. And similarly, e to the I and the A is 1 as an operator. And you can check that the correlation function I computed is consistent with these solutions of the equations of motion. So what are the observables? We can take e to the I phi and raise it the most to the nth power. When it raises it back to the nth power, we come back to ourselves. And similarly, with the operator e to the I a. I hope I made a mistake again. The same thing. Sorry? Ah, this part is blocked. So the only thing we need from here is this one. So I'll write it again. All the information can be extracted from this. And if I put integers here and here, so let's put an integer here, r, and here an integer r prime. So this is multiplied by r and r prime. Sorry? Right, I just vary the Lagrangian with respect to phi, and that has to be 0.
He asked if you're concerned about the fact that the action is therefore 0 on shell.
Well, the action is often 0 on shell. If you just take a scalar field theory, and you don't worry about total derivatives, or you write the Lagrangian for free field theory is phi box phi, the equation of motion is that box phi is 0. And then the Lagrangian is 0 on shell. And the reason this is not puzzling is that the Lagrangian is not really an operator in the theory. The Hamiltonian is, but the Lagrangian is not. There are many ways of saying it, but one is not allowed to use the equations of motion in the Lagrangian. This is the quick. So you see that the theory doesn't have local degrees of freedom. We've already seen that with the equations of motion. But it does have non-trivial correlation functions. This is a topological field theory. And in order to understand it a little better, let's try and do canonical quantization. So this is a textbook problem. This is a gauge theory. We have to fix a gauge. The convenient gauge is axial gauge. So we write A, 0, I, etc. equals 0. That's the analog of axial gauge. And we have to impose Gauss law. Gauss law is obtained by varying the Lagrangian with respect to the gauge condition. And that tells us that the I phi equals 0. So we have in mind some space and time running this way. So for me, time is going upwards, not to the left or to the right to avoid confusion. And time goes this way. I pick a gauge. And I have Gauss law. And now I am allowed to use the gauge condition and the Gauss law in the Lagrangian. And the action that I end up with is the n over 2 pi integral. Phi is now a constant. I pull it out. And what I'm left with is what I can call chi dot, where chi is the integral over space of A. And it's identified with chi plus 2 pi. So we end up with a quantum mechanical system. All of the dependence on space is gone. We end up with a quantum mechanical system integrated only over time, the time. with two compact degrees of freedom, phi and chi. In fact, they are, they are canonically conjugate to each other, as you can see from the Lagrangian. And fortunately, precisely this quantum mechanical system was discussed last week by Edward Witten, although in a totally different context. He studied a U1 Chern-Simons theory on the torus, and he ended up with exactly the same quantum mechanical system, where phi and chi arose from the holonomy of the gauge field around the two cycles of the torus. Here we end up with exactly the same quantum mechanical system, but for a different reason. And I hope I didn't forget any I. So how do we quantize it? Well, it's the same thing that he did in his talk. We have an n-dimensional Hilbert space with states labeled by k. K goes from 0 to n minus 1. And the operator e to the I phi on the state k gives us the state k plus 1. I decided to diagonalize this one, so it's e to the 2 pi I k over n is the state k. And the operator e to the I chi, which is my other operator on the state k, gives me the state k plus 1. So we have an n-dimensional Hilbert space. And the operators e to the I phi and e to the I chi, which are our two operators, act on it like that. This is known in the physics, in the high energy physics, as clock and shift. And we'll see this quantum mechanical system again later. And we identify k is identified with k plus n, because I said that k is 0 up to n minus 1. And if we get n here, it's the same as k. That's why it's called clock and shift. It's the same as 12 is identified with 0, the clock. So what's the physical interpretation of this system? This system has several different physical interpretations, or several different contexts in which we can find it. And all of them are useful. First, we can view it as a U1 gauge theory for this A. A bit, in general, it's a higher form gauge theory. But because of all these equations of motion, all that, only n root of unity appear. So interpretation number one is that this is a Zn gauge theory. Theory of A. Interpretation number two is this is a system with a Zn global symmetry. And I would like to spend some time discussing that. I said that we don't have the freedom to shift phi by an arbitrary amount because of this business with theta that I had there. But instead, we can only shift it by 2 pi over n. That, of course, doesn't do anything to the action. This is a generator of a Zn symmetry. And the operator e to the I phi, I'll move here, e to the I phi is the order parameter for the Zn symmetry. So we have a Zn global symmetry under which e to the I phi is charged. And we saw that there are n states with diagonalized phi with different charge. So when we act with phi, we measure this. So when we act with phi, we find this thing. Now imagine this system is in finite volume, then everything I said is correct. We have n states in the Hilbert space. Now let's take exactly the same system, but in infinite volume. In infinite volume, we have a phenomenon of spontaneous symmetry breaking. Spontaneous symmetry breaking means that instead of having n ground states, there's only one ground state, because there's no local operator that takes us from one to the other. We can see this here. The operator e to the I phi is the operator I diagonalized. That's a local operator. It acts on the state and it reads off a phase. The other operator, e to the I chi, acts on all of space. Recall e to the I chi is e to the I, an integral of A of all of space. So this operator is not a local operator. In order to move from one vacuum to another, we have to act on all of space. So This doesn't happen in the infinite volume limit. We can, physically, we only make experiments in some local neighborhood. We do not change everything arbitrarily far away. And therefore, the Hilbert space in infinite volume splits into n sectors. They are known as superselection sectors. And we live in one of them. And we say that the symmetry is spontaneously broken. Yeah. So if you embed that in the microscopic theory that has more stuff in it, this is kind of a very elementary description of only capturing the long distance physics, then it does not see all the, these effects which decay like e to the minus the volume. There will be all sorts of effects decay like e to the minus the volume that are not captured by this Lagrangian, by this simple system. There's another interpretation of this gadget. Where is it? This one. I said that, or when I wrote it here, e to the ia over m. So if m is on space, this is the operator that tries to take us from one vacuum to the other. This is the operator that implements the global symmetry transformation. Take a state and takes us to another. But we can also orient m along time. So in one of the directions in m is along time and the rest is along space, from the point of view of this system, it's all the same. I didn't make any distinction between space and time. And that also has an interpretation. This should be thought of from a point of view of our low energy observer with this system as a domain wall between different vacua. So a low energy observer says that the system has n vacua, finite volume, all of them are accessible. At infinite volume, they are not because we sit in one of them. And then imagine we come from short distances and we stick a domain wall that takes that has one vacuum on one side and the other vacuum on the other side. How does a low energy observer describe it? The low energy observer says that all he has to do is take this e to the ia and put it on the domain wall, and then his low energy field theory captures all the physics of the domain wall. More generally, the fields are such that whenever we cross this surface M, all the fields undergo a Zn transformation. And this is what this correlation function that I put at the top really tells us, that if we take the order parameter e to the I phi and we bring it across M, we cross the surface M, or we compare the correlation function when it's on one side to the correlation function when it's on the other side, the difference between them is a Zn phase. So what this M does when there's a on it, this extended operator, what it does is whenever we cross it, we undergo a Zn transformation. If it's on space, we just act on the state. If it is in space and time, this is a domain wall. So this is all I wanted to say about this trivial system. I hope this is clear. Yes? Sorry? In this case, the system is first order in time derivative, so the Hamiltonian is zero, which is just right, because if we have a system with a spontaneously broken Zn symmetry, there are n vacua. In finite volume, they are almost degenerate. So we have n states with zero energy.
To relate this to Dijkgraaf's talk, you can think of this also like a TQFT where the parent ants in this case is taking the product of these two Zn gerbs, and you get out another Zn gerb?
If I knew what the word gerb means, I would have agreed with.
Yeah,
but I'm going to, from this point on, you know, well, I'll have some gerbs later in the talk, and when I said it, I don't know what it means. I really exaggerated a little bit, but not by a lot. But as far as whatever we want to compute, this is as explicit as possible. I don't think you can get more explicit than that. If it's a free field theory, all the correlation functions are a closed form. So I'd like to make it a little bit richer. That's right.
However, if the space is a sphere, then the inside outside little bit.
Well, then the answer might be zero. Then the answer might be zero.
I see. So that this average, this.
It's not might. In that case, the answer is zero. Okay. And I leave it as an exercise for all of you to show that in that case. See, in all these simple systems, as I said, there's no room to hide because you can just compute it and get the answer. So I'd like to make it to get the system a little bit more interesting. And in order not to, keep it really simple, I'll stick to 1+1 dimensions. So that in this case, the gauge symmetry is, the A is an ordinary gauge field. And I don't need to discuss the subtleties of gerbs. But I'll make it a little bit more interesting. So now we'll be in 1+1 dimensions. So this is example 2. And now we are in D plus 1 dimensions. And I'm going to take 2 copies of this system. And first I'll just set N1 equals N2 equals 2. So my Lagrangian, or my action, is 2 over 2 pi, phi 1 dA 1 plus phi 2 dA 2. And again, phi is identified with phi plus 2 pi, and A is an ordinary U1 gauge field properly quantized. And again, we have the operators e to the I phi I and e to the I. Now it's a line integral of AI. And we basically repeat the previous story again. We have a global Z2 times Z2 symmetry. It's spontaneously broken. And we have 4 ground states and so forth. And you can go through Robert's construction in this theory. And where's my notes? You can go through Robert's construction, and everything works through. But I'd now like to make it a little bit more interesting. And the point is the following. We describe this system either as a Z2 times Z2 global symmetry, which is spontaneously broken, or as a Z2 times Z2 gauge theory, where these A's are really U1, but the equation of motion of phi sets it effectively to a Z2 gauge theory. And as a Z2 times Z2 gauge theory, this system should have a deformation. I forgot the integral sign. This system has a deformation, first found by Dyckhoff and Witten, and I assume Robert is going to discuss it tomorrow. But I'm going to discuss it now from the point of view of this trivial Lagrangian. So I'm going to add a term to the Lagrangian, so which it's an elaboration of this system. So my action is going to be the same as before, 2 over 2 pi integral phi 1 dA 1 plus phi 2 dA 2 plus A 1 A 2. And I suppress the wedge. So that looks like a no-no because it's not gauge invariant. You normally don't see a term in the Lagrangian that multiplies 2 gauge fields. But in this case, you can easily fix it by saying that the gauge transformations of AI, which was originally AI goes to AI plus D lambda I, now we assign transformation laws to phi I where this epsilon ij is 1 or minus 1, depending if it's 1, 2, or 2, 1. It's the standard one. And I leave it as an exercise for you to substitute it in and check. From the right or from the left?
From the right.
Since this is important, I'll put it here on the middle.
You could rewrite the part of this report, just a little bit
to well, this is the
only.
Ah, so this is the main thing that is missing? So this is the Lagrangian we're going to study for the next few minutes. We are adding A1, A2. And I leave it as an exercise for you to check that up to a total derivative, this Lagrangian is indeed, this action is invariant. And we'll discuss the surface term soon. But at the moment, let's just substitute it in and integrate by parts freely and check that it is gauge invariant. OK, so if it is a gauge invariant theory, we can ask, what does it do? So we do the same things we did before. We try to construct the gauge invariant operators. So the first thing we can do is write e to the I, line integral of ai, let's call that ui. That's clearly gauge invariant. This is a good object to study. Another thing we could do is try to what we had before was e to the I, boom, phi I inserted at the point. That's what we had before we added this term. But now that we added this term, it's not gauge invariant, so we'll just make it gauge invariant by add here minus I epsilon ij line integral from p to p prime aj minus I phi I at the point p prime. And all this is in the exponent. So these are candidate operators to study. And all we need to do now is check whether they have interesting correlation functions. And the answer is that they don't. So let me prove that. That depends on 2 points. So this is a circle, it's a line like that. And this starts at the point P. There's a line going to the point P prime. And you see that I cannot have a gauge invariant operator inserted at the point. I have to have a line going out of it. Okay, so this is a gauge invariant object. So what do we know about the correlation functions of these objects? Well, they're trivial. The first thing that is obvious is the square of this is zero. That's the same way it was, it is one. The square of this is one. So that's the first thing which is obvious. It's the same thing, the same way it was before, just from the phi equation of motion. This object is a little bit more interesting, but our theory is topological. And as a topological theory, we have a line, and we have another thing which is a line with two ends. There's no way we can get anything non-trivial because we can always remove the points and squeeze it. So even if it does something complicated, I can always unwind it. So this operator is trivial. Furthermore, even this operator is trivial. Because you see, we can take this closed line and imagine it's not really closed, but we have these two insertions here at two nearby points. So this object is exactly the same when I fuse phi and phi prime, p and p prime together. So this line is, this is trivial and this is trivial. And our conclusion is that this field theory that we have just written down does not have any interesting operators. This sounds like a shame. It miraculously manages to be gauge invariant. But there's nothing we can do with it because it does not have any interesting observables. Not just no local observables, also no line observables. So in order to make it a little bit more interesting, let's put a boundary. This is exactly what Robert instructed us to do. Put a boundary and then you get more diagnostics of the system. Yes? That's right. If I remove the A1, A2 term, then it's non-trivial. Well, it's simple, but it has something, some structure in it. It has a Z2 times Z2 global symmetry, which is spontaneously broken. But this system, as it stands, has nothing. Which one? Because what can we do? We are in 1 plus 1 dimensions. We can have a line. There's another line which has two ends. You can always remove it. Right, the theory is topological. It does not, it depends only on the topology. There's no non-trivial topology for the line with two ends because I can always move it back. You can also, since it's a quadratic Lagrangian or Gaussian, if you don't believe me, just do the calculation. It's not, you don't even have complicated Feynman diagrams. So let's put the system with a boundary. And now we have to put boundary conditions. And as Robert told us, there are many ways to put boundary conditions, and we have to be careful, and we might get different answers depending on the boundary conditions. So I'll do it in two different ways. I'll do that two different ways, and fortunately, they will give the same answer. So there's a guideline when you want to pick boundary conditions. The guideline is that if you look at the variation of the action, it's always of the form something times delta of fields, plus some surface terms where we call this the equation of motion. That's for any action. And then there's something, so if we have a manifold N and here we have dN, then there's something here with, again, variation of the fields. And this term comes either from the fields that we had in the bulk Lagrangian or from extra fields that where we integrated by parts or from fields that we added along the boundary. And the boundary conditions are such that this thing vanishes. So the simplest thing we can do is we don't add anything to this Lagrangian, just take it at face value and ask what kind of boundary conditions can we put. Then the variation of the action has all sorts of bulk terms, plus along the boundary, we find 2 over 2 pi, phi I delta AI summed over AI. That's along the boundary. This is my notation for along the boundary. So we have to pick boundary conditions. And the simplest thing I can do, which is how I'll start, I'm going to start with set Dirichlet boundary condition, telling us that A along the boundary vanishes. So I'm setting A along the boundary to 0. The reason I don't want to set phi to 0 is that I'm after this global symmetry that shifts phi by a constant. So I don't want to mess with that with the boundary conditions. So I pick boundary conditions that preserve that symmetry, because that's what we'll discuss later. And we put these boundary conditions. Now, if we have this boundary condition, then the gauge symmetry is fixed. We are not allowed to do gauge transformations along the boundary unless they're constant. Gauge transformations along the boundary will change the boundary conditions. So the gauge group is restricted. It's restricted to gauge transformations that vanish along the boundary. And therefore, we have new operators that we can study. So the first thing we can do is we can put integral in I of A up to a point on the boundary. Prime. P and P prime are on the boundary. So this is a new object we can study. And also we can study e to the I phi on the boundary because it's also gauge invariant. Right? We do the same thing we did before, but now we're no longer restricted by the gauge invariance. So we can study these objects. And we can ask, what are their correlation functions? So I'm just going to give the answer, and then I'll prove it. I'll prove it with another choice. I'm going to call that, this one, V tilde at the point P, V tilde I. And the answer is that V tilde I square is 1. That's obvious. It's the same way it was before. But the non-trivial thing is that V tilde 1, V tilde 2 is minus V tilde 2, V tilde 1. So what we see is that we started with a global Z2 times Z2 symmetry. And nothing happened in the bulk, which we'll soon have to interpret it physically. And along the boundary, we have things that are charged under the Z2 times Z2. But more precisely, there's a crucial minus sign here, which is a central extension of Z2 times Z2. And Robert already alluded to that earlier this morning, that this thing can happen. Yes? V tilde I is here. I forgot the equal sign. It's the same thing as, so it's an operator instead of the point. It cannot exist in the bulk, because in the bulk it's not gauge invariant. But from this perspective, it's perfectly gauge invariant along the boundary, so we can put it there. I would like to give another physical interpretation of what's going on here. We started with a system that has a global Z2 times Z2 symmetry. Without the extra term, we saw that the symmetry was spontaneously broken, and there were these four ground states, finite volume. Now we see that there are no non-trivial operators. What does it mean? What happened to the global symmetry? We can say one of two things. Number one, the global Z2 times Z2 symmetry that we had was actually gauged, as we can see from here. The Z2 transformation shifts phi, so phi transforms under that. So the global symmetry is gauge. It's not really a symmetry, and therefore it doesn't have to be realized. Another interpretation of that is that we have a system at short distance that has a global Z2 times Z2 symmetry. Without the extra term, the symmetry was spontaneously broken, giving us these four ground states. But with the extra term, I'd like to argue that the global symmetry is unbroken, and therefore there's only one ground state in the bulk. Along the boundary, we see some remnant of the global symmetry, and it appears as the central extension of Z2 times Z2. So all I need to do now to finish this description is to derive this result. Before I derive this result, are there any questions? None. Okay, so somebody might come with a point of view that gauge symmetry is sacred, and as such, I pick boundary conditions that violate the gauge symmetry. We should have a description that is more gauge invariant so that all the gauge symmetry is manifest. And there's a simple prescription to do that that I think historically goes back to Mr. Stuckelberg. Mr. Stuckelberg said that whenever you have a gauge symmetry, you can always think of the gauge parameter as being a field. And then everything becomes trivially gauge invariant. I'll do it here as an example, and I'll solve this problem in the course of doing that. Imagine I do not impose that the gauge parameter is zero on the boundary. So I'm doing this gauge transformation that I gave you here as an exercise, now paying attention to the surface term. So now when I perform the gauge transformation, there's a surface term in the equation of motion, in the variation, and the variation is 2 over 2 pi, an integral over the boundary. And now we have lambda 1 d lambda 2 plus lambda 1 a 2 minus lambda 2 a 1. So I gave you an exercise to verify that up to a surface term, this thing is invariant. And the next exercise is do the same exercise, paying attention to the surface term and integrate by parts and derive this variation of the action. So this action that I wrote there is gauge invariant in the bulk, but not in the boundary because of this term. In order to fix that, we add boundary modes, phi tilde, identify I, phi tilde I. These are periodic scalars living only on the boundary, such that they transform under the gauge symmetry. Oh, there's the mirror image of this problem. Is this visible from there? So the problem occurs only on that side?
Well, the last 6 inches of the problem.
Ah, I see, because there is some parity here. So, and I postulate that these scalars living on the boundary transform by lambda I also. So I'm now going to construct a boundary action such that I'll write something on the boundary that will exactly cancel the mistake from the bulk. And so I write here S boundary is minus 2 over 2 pi integral, it's only along the boundary, phi tilde 1 d phi tilde 2 plus phi 1, I don't have room here. This is readable. But in any event, I give it exercise number 3. Verify the gauge invariance in the boundary, that on the bulk. This was the first one. Pay attention to the surface term. Derive this variation. This is number 2. And number 3, vary this term. I gave you the gauge transformation, and then check that it exactly cancels the mistake from the bulk. So the bottom line is that if we add these boundary fields, we haven't done anything conceptual because we said we had a problem with gauge symmetry, so we just added fields that will take care of these gauge variation. So now the system is completely gauge invariant. We added more degrees of freedom on the boundary. And now we should repeat the whole analysis But now we have to be careful about the gate symmetry. Another way of saying it is that this gate system along the boundary is a quantum mechanical system that is not gauge invariant under this gauge transformation. Because of this term, you might say, aha, this looks like a gauge symmetry, like it has a gauge symmetry. But in fact, it does not. It has an anomaly which is canceled by the anomaly from the bulk. So you can look at it either the bulk fixes the boundary or the boundary fixes the bulk, but together they live happily.
Is there a typo?
Probably.
You wrote down two fields, but your boundary term only has one of them.
No.
Tilde,
no, here there's I, so I sum over I. And here there's one and two. This is I. No, no, it's the same phi. And there could also be typos in addition to that. So that's why the exercise is not completely trivial, because. Okay, so once all the typos are fixed and the characters are fixed, the statement is correct that we have a system which has a gauge problem on the boundary, has a gauge problem coming from the bulk, and the two cancel each other. And now we should just analyze what this system does. So the first thing to do is to look at the equations of motion. There's one thing I want you to learn from my talk, that whenever you're faced with a field theory, the first thing to do is to examine the equations of motion, because that already captures a lot of the physics. So the equation of motion here basically tells us that d phi tilde, tilde I, plus ai from the bulk restricted to the boundary is zero. This shouldn't surprise us. The previous analysis, which I call Dirichlet boundary conditions, is basically a gauge-fixed version of this one, where I fix the gauge phi tilde equals zero. So in the gauge phi tilde equals zero, all this is gone, but now I no longer have the full gauge symmetry because I fixed the value of phi tilde. And there we had this Dirichlet boundary condition. Now everything is manifestly gauge invariant, so we should have something gauge invariant. So what are the operators? So this is the system I want to keep. And I want to keep that. So what are the operators we can write down? So it's essentially the same as with Dirichlet boundary conditions, except that whenever we see an operator that we saw there, which was not gauge invariant, we make it gauge invariant by dressing it with phi tilde. The whole purpose of phi tilde is to restore the gauge symmetry. So take anything that we wrote before. I wrote them up there. So we had this operator e to the I phi, the p, and we had e to the I with a going to a point p on the boundary. Now they are not gauge invariant, but that's easy to fix, because all we need to do is dress them with this phi tilde. So I hope there would not be any typo. So the operators I have are I can integrate from p to p prime, okay? So now let me make them gauge invariant. So I can construct e to the minus I phi tilde at the point p along the boundary with an I, e to the I integral from p to p prime of little a, I, e to the I phi tilde at the point p prime. And I can also construct the operator v tilde I, the point p along the boundary, which is e to the I phi tilde at the point p. This is I, and minus I epsilon ij phi j at the point p. So these are the same operators we discussed before, except that now they're dressed with phi tilde to make them gauge invariant. So now we have nice gauge invariant operators, and we can ask, what are their correlation functions? And fortunately, it's easy to do. Because let's look at this Lagrangian. These terms here are precisely the quantum mechanical system that appeared earlier in the talk, and it's the same quantum mechanical system that Witten described last week in another context. So this system describes a central extension of Z2 times Z2, and therefore it gives us this minus sign that I wanted. Now all I have to do is dress with a phi, and I end up with the same answer. So what's the upshot of all that? We started with this system. It has a Z2 times Z2 global symmetry. It's here. And then we added a term. The Z2 times Z2 was not realized in the bulk at all. In fact, the bulk was completely trivial. But along the boundary, we found something non-trivial. We found the central extension of Z2 times Z2 with some boundary states acting on the boundary. This is a symmetry-protected topological phase, and this is a trivial example of phenomena discussed by Kane last week. Are there any questions about this example? None. Okay, so I'd like to make it a little bit richer in order to exhibit a new phenomenon. Yes. Yeah, so the boundary could be a circle, and this is P, and this could be P prime, and the line could go to the bulk this way, or we can have two circles on the boundary. The boundary could have this joint, you know, two circles, and P can run like, the line could run like that.
So the operator depends on the
equation? Yes, absolutely, and that's why the ordering comes in. You could ask, where did the ordering come from? All I'm doing is kind of Euclidean functional integral. Everything manifestly commutes with anything else, right? I'm doing kind of Euclidean path integral. All the things commute. Where did the lack of commutativity come from? The lack of commutativity comes from the ordering along the boundary. That's the only place lack of commutativity can come from. And in the next example, we'll see how this is important. Yes?
The model you've just given here is in 1+1 dimension.
Yes. I'm not sure about that particular model, but this one has Z2 times Z2. I'm not sure that the SSH model has Z2 times Z2. But we should consult with
maybe with two chains.
Yeah, they are actually, there's huge literature on this system from many different points of view on the lattice and others, and with various spins that are in Z2 times Z2 in the bulk, with various dimerization that leave you in the end two spins living on the ends. So there are various realizations of that. The presentation here is doing it all in the continuum, not in the lattice, and uses features that I will soon generalize. So I'm building here features. Kind of every model will have some new elements that I will gradually build to something. OK? So would like to make it a little richer. And didn't use this one. So we'll do it in steps. And the first thing I'll do is take this system with Z2 times Z2 and just generalize it to Zn1 times Zn2. So it's the same thing. So I have two over 2 pi, integral n1 phi1 dA1 plus n2 phi2 dA2, and just start with that. So that's a Zn1 times Zn2 system, exactly as before. It's a global symmetry. It has n1 times n2 states, if we quantize on the circle. And it has this operator, e to the I phi, and the lines. It's exactly as I did before. One over two pi, thank you. I'm very encouraged when I'm asked these questions because it shows that some people pay attention. Okay, so that's kind of a trivial extension of what we did before, but I'd like to do something that's slightly less trivial. And I'm going to motivate it by the previous discussion. So we should just add here A1, A2. And we have to figure out what the coefficient should be. And I'll normalize it in a convenient way. So it's a parameter p times the lowest common multiple of n1 and n2. And the point is that this p has to be quantized. I'll write, soon explain why. And the previous example was n1 equals n2 equals 2, and p was 1. That's what the example we had before. And now, in order to see what it could be, let's just write the gauge symmetry. So ai goes to ai plus d lambda I. That's the same as before. And phi 1. Okay, this is called lowest common multiple of n1 and n2. So that if you have the same factor in n1 and n2, you multiply them, but if you have the same factor, you take it only once. And I'm going to write that as phi I goes to phi I minus epsilon ij lambda j. And here there is a factor here, which depends on nj. And I'm going to define big P and big K. And I apologize for the many characters. This is little p, this is big P. Greatest common divisor of p and 1 and n2. And k is the greatest common divisor of n1 and n2. The details are not important. We'll say soon what is important, common divisor of p, n1, and n2. So out of p, n1, and n2, we can form some integers, p and k. And the gauge transformation is modified in this way, such that the whole thing is gauge invariant. So every letter that you see here is an integer, p and k and this one. But if we want the coefficient here to be quantized, then this p should be an integer. So everything here has to be an integer. And you can check, it's not a lot of work, I'll give it as an exercise for you, that p can be 0. That's the trivial theory, 1. And then there could be higher values going all the way to the greatest common divisor of n1 and n2 minus 1. So we have a bunch of different deformations of this original system labeled by the integer p. And all of them are gauge invariant, and all of them are given by such a Lagrangian. And conceptually, it's very similar to the previous example, except that one subtlety that I'll soon highlight. So this is, again, a free field theory. There is no excuse not to understand it. And we should just work it out. So all the steps will be essentially the same as before, so I will do it rapidly to see what happens. No, because there's an epsilon. Phi 1 transforms with lambda 2, and phi 2 transforms with lambda 1, because otherwise you see. See, we start with phi 1, a1, and phi 2, a2. Now, the gauge transformation of phi 1 has lambda 2, so that it will cancel the term from the last one. And there could be typos. No, but the fact that phi 1 transforms with lambda 2 and phi 2 transforms with lambda 1, I think this was true already here. And the only thing that happened between this example and that is that this was decorated with more prefactors here and there. The prefactors are going to do something new. But other than that, it's the same thing. So what are the operators? We'll do the same thing we did before. Namely, we attempt to write gauge invariant operators. And question? We'll attempt to write gauge invariant operators. And so the logic will be now identical to what we had before. We'll attempt to write gauge invariant operators. We'll realize that some of them are trivial. The new thing that will happen now is that some of them will not be trivial. Only a subset will be trivial. And then we'll go to the boundary, and along the boundary, we'll recover all the operators, recovering the full structure. But unlike the previous example, there will be something non-trivial already in the bulk. So that would be the new thing. So we have to write gauge invariant operators. So ui is e to the I line integral of ai. That's clearly good, and it's gauge invariant. It might be trivial, but it's a good operator to have. And I could also define vi, I'll call it hat, because it will soon disappear, e to the I phi I at the point p, e to the minus I epsilon ij, p and j. Again, the details are not important. Integral from p to p prime of aj, e to the minus I phi I of p prime. Okay, so this is very similar to what we had before. The new thing that happened is that there are all these integers that decorate everything. And in particular, we have a prefactor here. And before, this prefactor was 1. Since this prefactor is not 1, there is room for new phenomena. Specifically, if we raise this prefactor to be exactly nj, so imagine we raise this thing to high enough power so that we have nj times aj, this line between the two operators is invisible. And if this line is invisible, we can pretend it's not there and find genuinely local operators. We just throw away this line. There are no correlation functions for these lines. It can move through other insertions without changing them. So when I do that, I need to rush. I learned that vi hat to the power k, let's raise that to the power k. It kills this k here in the denominator. I told you that everything is an integer. We have nj times aj. This can freely move around. So therefore, it has no effect whatsoever where it is. So I can just forget about it and call this guy vi at the point p. I can even send p prime to infinity to another point. It doesn't matter. This is a local operator. It does not need a choice of a line. Or you can make a choice of a line, but it makes no effect on the answer. So now we have a good local operator. And we already said that we can raise v to the nth power, but now we can raise it to a lower power. So now vi, this vi to the power ni over k is 1. So we have fewer operators. Also, I can do the same trick with the u's. I said before that some of the u's are trivial because I can open them up. I cannot open up u itself because I can only open up things which have this exponent in it. So I can only open, I cannot open up u. So u is a non-trivial operator. But u to the power ni over k is 1. So this is the algebra of operators. I can send it to infinity, send it to any point you want. It makes no effect on the answer. So what do we see here? It is as if we took the original system that has n1, ni, and p, and mapped that to ni over k. This is an integer, and p equals 0. So as far as the bulk correlation functions, this system is identical to the system of ni over k, smaller value. So we had a big Zn, now we have a smaller n. N p equals 0. So that's like this trivial system that has just the ordinary global symmetry. So all the bulk correlation functions are as if the global symmetry is z n 1 over k times z n 2 over k. And we can assign to this the same language that we did before in the z2 times z2. We started with the Zn times Zn symmetry, Zn1 times Zn2 symmetry. Part of it was gauged, as we can see here. We can see here that part of it was gauged. And since part of it is gauged, it's not visible at low energies. So it is as if we started with Zn1 times Zn2. That's for p equals 0. And then we gauged a ZK times ZK subgroup of it. And therefore, what the low energy observer sees is only the quotient . Alternatively, we can say that we started the throat distance with a system that has a full ZN1 times ZN2 global symmetry. It was described by the Grandjean up there with P equals 0. The fact that P is non-zero means that a subgroup of that ZN times ZN global symmetry was unbroken. It's unbroken, therefore, from the low energy point of view, it's not there. It was gauged, all the relevant operators were removed. And what the low energy observer sees is only the quotient of the full global symmetry that is available, modded out by the symmetry that was unbroken. And this is the space that describes the broken symmetries. But, sorry? Well, continuous symmetry, if it's spontaneously broken, it has Goldstone bosons. So it has local excitations in the bulk. Here, this is a topological field theory. There's almost nothing there. All that remains is this keeping track of the ground states. Okay, so unlike the previous example, which was N1 equals N2 equals 2 and P equals 1, in this case, we are left with some excitations in the bulk. There are some, not excitation, I would say there are these lines and points in the bulk representing this number of ground states. So that's new compared with the previous example. But we should ask ourselves, what happened to the full ZN1 times ZN2 global symmetry? In the previous example, that full symmetry was visible only when we looked at the boundary. So it's completely obvious what we need to do now is go to the boundary, and we'll have the same tildes and the same story we had before. We'll construct operators that are gauge invariant in the boundary and pick boundary conditions, construct operators, and discuss their algebra and see what happens to the symmetry on the boundary. Despite giving hundreds of talks in this room, I still can't manage the block point. So option number one, we'll just set AI equals 0. This would be Dirichlet boundary conditions. And now we have local operators along the boundary, e to the I phi I. And I'll just state the answer that e to the I phi 1, e to the I phi 2 is going to be e to the minus 2 pi I, this big P over big K, e to the I phi 2, e to the I, oh, something is not visible, sorry. So we have these operators along the boundary, and they don't commute, just as before, for reasons that would be essentially the same what we had before. But before, we had just a minus sign. So, sorry? So I first pick Dirichlet boundary conditions for A. Set A to 0. So on the bulk, I couldn't write e to the I phi, because e to the I phi was not gauge invariant. On the boundary, I can put e to the I phi, because when I pick Dirichlet boundary conditions, the gauge parameter is zero on the boundary. Okay? So I'm just stating the answer. They don't commute, but there's an interesting factor here, which means that e to the ik phi I do commute. Right? If you just raise any of them to the kth power, it cancels the k here, e to the 2 pi I gives 1. What's the physical interpretation of that? First, from the algebra, it's clear. But we said before that the bulk now has local operators. Didn't have before. If we raise e to the I phi to the kth power, I wrote it somewhere here, this one. This is a local operator in the bulk. So how can operators fail to commute along the boundary if I put them in one order or in the other order? So if I reverse the order, so I move P1 and P2, interchange them, so I change the order, then the operators, don't commute in general. But in case the operator on the boundary is the limit, the boundary limit of a bulk operator, it must commute. Because this operator can wander away from the boundary, because it's a bulk operator, and come back in the opposite order. The order means only for operators that cannot wander into the bulk. And that's why we get a non-trivial factor here with k, such that these operators are not really boundary operators. These are limits of bulk operators. And therefore, they're central. So all I need to do is derive this factor. Are there any questions?
Sorry, this ik phi I is part of some formula. Into the ik phi I, where it belongs.
This is an operator, O. This is a boundary operator. The boundary operators are generated by this object. So let me give it a name, V. So V to the k is also a boundary operator. But it's also a bulk operator, so we shouldn't count it twice, because we already counted all the bulk operator. Every bulk operator can wander to the boundary and become a boundary operator, but that's not new. The new guys are those that cannot move away from the boundary, and they don't commute. The operators that can move to the bulk do commute. There was another question here. Yes. Well, mathematically, it's a cousin of it. But physically, I don't see the relation. So all I need to do is derive this result. And I'll do that the same way I did before. And I think I have enough time to do that. So what did we do before? We said that somebody might not like the boundary conditions that the gauge field vanishes along the boundary. Would rather have boundary conditions that are fully gauge invariant. So whenever you have boundary conditions that are not gauge invariant, it's easy to turn them into gauge invariant boundary conditions, but just doing the gauge transformation, it's not invariant, and just say that this is another field. And so we are going to add on the boundary, add boundary fields. Fields living only on the boundary, phi tilde I, which transform phi tilde I minus lambda I. And I'm going to write a boundary action. It's minus 1 over 2 pi integral along the boundary only. P lowest common multiple n1 and n2. Phi 1 tilde d phi 2 tilde plus ni phi I tilde d phi I tilde plus AI. And again, the details are not important. What is important is that I leave it as an exercise to you. Work out the gauge transformations in the bulk, this thing. Fix all the typos. Work it out. Realize that it's gauge invariant in the bulk. So the term that we added to phi exactly cancels the mistake from the last term. In doing that, we have to integrate by parts. First, we just neglect all the total derivatives, but then we don't neglect the total derivatives, and we look at the surface term. The surface term is non-trivial. And if we just add this term to the Lagrangian with this transformation law, this is also not gauge invariant, but together these two terms cancel each other. So altogether we have a gauge invariant system, which can be described as having an anomaly on the boundary, an inflow of anomaly from the bulk. We can describe it many different ways. One of them is you just fix the gauge phi tilde equals zero. And for phi tilde equals zero, we no longer have gauge freedom on the boundary. And we go back to the previous description with the with Dirichlet boundary conditions. Now all the operators on the, along the boundary can be dressed. All the operators we had before can be dressed by powers of phi tilde. So it's exactly as before. And this term here is our friend, the same quantum mechanical system that we had before. Two-dimensional phase space, phi 1 tilde and phi 2 tilde, with a certain coefficient, p, the lowest common multiple of n1 and n2. There's a comma here. And the commutation relations are exactly as before. So we construct the operators made out of phi tilde. Not all of, so if we all had only this term, we would say that we have this clock and shift with p times lowest common multiple of n1 and n2. We have p times lowest common multiple of n1 and n2 dimensional Hilbert space. But not all these phi tildes are gauge invariant. Only a subset of them are gauge invariant. And those that are gauge invariant are precisely the ones we discussed here. And as we do that, we derive this thing. And that's what I can write the formulas for that now. But before I do that, since I'm approaching the end, I want to see if there are any questions. Phi I. So one of them is a typo. I assume that's a tilde here. But it could be a mistake here. Well, I think the question should be the opposite. Why does it work? Miraculous that it works at all. And it's not why did I choose that. It's not that there are billions of options. If you want to add anything to this Lagrangian, then it should be topological. There aren't that many things you can add. And most things that you try to add are manifestly wrong. And it's kind of surprising that such a simple term does the job. More or less, yeah. What else can you write? It has to be topological. And the cast of characters are the phi's and the a's. So there might be higher terms, like phi 1, phi 2 times some phi. But that would not be invariant under the periodicity of the phi i's. Right? There aren't that many things you can attempt to write down. And if you can manage to write something, I think it would guarantee to give some new interesting phenomena. The thing about this one is that it's still a free field theory. So everything is very explicitly calculable. It's a free field theory, it's Gaussian, everything is calculable.
Can you get this theory by dimensional reduction of
the billion? I'm not sure, because what you will find there, you will find all sorts of other things. But I'll have something to say about this probably tomorrow. I think so. Yeah, this piece.
Of the symmetry group.
Yep. Yep.
So this ties in very nicely with this kind of classification.
Yep.
The 1D topological phases for the symmetry now.
Yep.
Classified by the distinct.
Right.
Projective.
Right. As I said before, this thing was done before. It's not new from many different points of view. This discussion with the continuum has some advantages. First, it's a continuum discussion. So you can put on the lattice whatever you want, and it realizes it. There's no claim that this is the most general thing that can happen. And it suggests a generalization that I'll discuss tomorrow, which I do not know how to do in a simple way otherwise. So that's why I went through all that, because not only is it, I think it's pedagogical, because you take a free field theory that demonstrates these more general considerations that I, for one, did not know before I learned the field. So that was good for a school. But second, it naturally leads to some extensions that are easily, from this point of view, are completely straightforward. Just do the same thing again, but were not done before. Any more questions? Yeah. There are two different descriptions of the same thing. And this is a general phenomenon in physics. When you have something that is not gauge invariant, you can always make it gauge invariant by adding what is known as Stuckelberg fields. Basically say, act with a gauge transformation. It's not invariant, so you'll find some terms. And add new fields, I call them phi tilde, which are there, which are shifted in exactly the same way as to fix it. Conversely, if you're given this gauge description, gauge invariant description, go to the gauge phi tilde equals zero. This is a gauge choice. There's nothing wrong with that. And that gives you the previous description. Now, this is not to say that you can't have other boundary conditions. You can take this system and add 17 more scalars on the boundary with all sorts of boundary interactions and so forth. You could. But this is kind of the minimal thing that you can have. You could also have boundary conditions that say phi equals zero on the boundary and analyze that. The same thing is true, but this will break the global symmetry. So here we limited ourselves, which is again resonates with this whole discussion in the condensed matter literature, that we have some global symmetry that we want to preserve. On the boundary, we pick boundary conditions that preserve that global symmetry. The gate symmetry we can easily do with or without. And then we analyze it one way or another. I really want to emphasize this point, which I think is quite significant. Most of the discussion in the literature, as far as I can tell, highlights the underlying gauge symmetry. People write a Hamiltonian or a Lagrangian that has a gauge symmetry, and then you can ask, what kind of terms can we add that preserves the gauge symmetry? And this is wonderful because this is a machine that produces consistent theories. But as we have seen here, gauge symmetries can come and go. Here we had a description of a system with U1 times U1 gauge symmetry, which in the end looks a lot like a ZN1 times ZN2 gauge symmetry. And what's really important about this system is not so much its gauge symmetry, but its global symmetry. Global symmetries are intrinsic to the problem. They are unambiguous. So if you have a system which has some global ZN symmetry, that's unambiguous. It has that symmetry. It's independent of how you describe it. If it has a gauge symmetry, we've already seen that with the example with the boundary conditions. You can have boundary conditions with this Dirichlet, but the gauge symmetry is not there. Or we can add the Stuckelberg fields, and then the gauge symmetry is there. All the descriptions are in the end consistent. And for some purposes, one of them might be better for another. There might be a dual description of this whole system with a totally different gauge symmetry. And that's very common, that you have dual descriptions with different gauge symmetries. You cannot have dual descriptions with different global symmetries. If the global symmetries are different, then the systems are different. So here I really zoom on the global symmetry, not on the gauge symmetry. And the whole discussion here traced what happened to the global symmetry. We had the ZN1 times ZN2 global symmetry. A subgroup of it was unbroken. That was this ZK cross ZK. At low energies, we see only the quotient of the two. This is the space of vacua, the quotient between the full symmetry and the bounded out by the unbroken symmetry. And on the boundary, we can have all sorts of fun stuff with the unbroken symmetry. So I hope this answers your question. I think we have time for one more question. Yes, there's a huge literature on that, which I do not do justice to in this talk. There are lattice systems that realize that, and there are all sorts of conceptual ways of deriving the same answer. So in that sense, this is not new. I think it's the quickest way to get it because it's in the continuum, and I'm used to the continuum field theory. Other people prefer the lattice, then you could use the lattice. Some people prefer Hamiltonian formulation, others prefer Lagrangian formulation. All of them are good, and they all have their pros and cons. Again, I emphasize that this one leads naturally to some extensions. So I think it's time for lunch.